From the News Channel 5 Network, this is Urban Outlook.
And hello and welcome to Urban Outlook. I'm April Leighton. Thank you so much for being with us today. You know, for those of us who have students who are close or getting ready to go to college, you may be experiencing a bit of sticker shock. The school year's winding down, the college applications are in, you're starting to get some of those acceptance letters back, and then you figure out how much it really is going to cost you to get that student to college. You may have a plan in place or you may not, but here's some facts from Money Magazine. They say that the average cost of a public college these days is about $22,300. That's the average cost. That includes the tuition, room and board, books, and fees. And that takes up nearly a third of the annual income for a typical family. And then if you want to do the private college route, the average asking price is $43,500, and that's equal to about 60% of that family's pay. But if you've got a plan in place, then you probably feel pretty good about all of these numbers that you're seeing. If not, it may not be too late to put a plan in place really quickly. So we've got a couple of guests on the show who are going to help us do just that. We're going to start off first, though, with Tamara Kittrell Teague, who has a service called Information Village, a way to help parents and students, but mostly parents, figure out that plan to get their kid to college and keep their kid in college. Thank you so much for being here, Tamara.
Thank you for having me.
So let's start with Information Village and how this all came about. Tell me about this service.
Well, Information Village came about by my experience as a parent. I have fraternal twins, and when they had gotten to high school, I was totally confused with what to do, how to get them prepared. I didn't know where to start, where to look, and with my background in research, I just began to look up scholarships. I began to understand what steps to take in order to properly help my children become prepared for post-secondary education. And so what Information Village does is I take my knowledge as a parent and my experience as a parent and share that information with other families and parents. I utilize my village in that my friends and family members who are in academia, whereby I tap their knowledge and I work with them and try to help parents gather a plan of action in order to help their children become prepared for post-secondary education.
You kind of have a two-pronged approach, some might say. First, it's getting the academics in place or whatever you need in place.
Correct.
To get yourself to the college you want to go to. And
that's
then
it.
It's finding the resources to get there. So talk a little bit about how you work that out. Because as you said, you've got twins.
I do.
Two different little kiddos there.
Correct.
Who are now sophomores in college.
Sophomores in college.
But you had to take two different approaches with both of them.
I did. I had a student athlete and I had a young lady, my daughter, who is an incredible had excellent grades. So my approach was what I started by, first of all, organizing based on their interests. What did they want to do? What were their goals and so forth? So once we figured out what type of college suit their needs and where they wanted to go, I then looked at, so what does it take to get to this college? What money does this particular university offer? Then I worked with those, with trying to find additional funds and resources in order to get them prepared, because many scholarships that are even through the school, they have certain deadlines tied to them. They many of them require interviews, letters of recommendation, and so those are things that I help other parents organize for their own children that I had to do for myself. And then with my son, who was an athlete, it was just a matter of getting his name out there, getting to him to camps and those kind of things, and making sure he was properly trained in order to, get out there and earn a scholarship in athletics.
Our family is going through this process now, and what I've discovered is that some of the universities offer packages, scholarships and things like that. But there's so many other resources out there from so many different organizations, not-for-profit organizations, big charities, major groups that are offering scholarships. It's just a matter of finding all of that stuff. And you talk about your research background. How important is it that you really do some digging and find all of those resources and then try not to get overwhelmed as you continue to apply for all these things?
That's what I work with the parents on. Once we have an understanding of what suits the child, what the child's what they may qualify for, then we begin to set down dates. Okay, these deadlines are important. This is what we need to do to get there. And once we dig all the, then I look for additional information. For instance, if there is a certain question that may come up regarding the money, or you know, are these funds still available? First come, first serve many times. And so, you know, what I do is I try to help the parents understand the importance of the organization. Mm-hmm. And that's the big thing, is being organized, making sure they have a good idea of their deadlines that are coming up, and making sure that they have all the information in front of them whereby they can just easily navigate through that process, because it is overwhelming. Many times there may be scholarships out there that the parents didn't know existed because they don't have that research background. So that's what I do to facilitate, you know, for the parents mm-hmm. on their behalf, is to get everything organized and put it in front of them in an organized way so they can then, you know, take it from there and work with their child.
Hopefully people have gotten an early start on this.
Yes.
But if they haven't, is it too late to start? I mean, realistically, you should probably start before they even get into high school, right?
Absolutely.
Start preparing academically, what classes they need to take, what track they need to be on in order to get to college.
Correct.
But if you didn't do all that pre-planning, what tips do you give for people?
The biggest tip I say is to go ahead and just start looking for the little one-off scholarships and start locally. Begin, you know, the little $500, the $1,000. There's no cap on how many of those type of scholarships you can apply for. Mm. There's not. Mm-hmm. So what I tell parents is, if you're just now getting started, your child goes to school this coming fall, start now. Do your FAFSA. Get that in. It opens up January 1st.
And talk about that
2014.
Form.
That FAFSA form is online.
Mm-hmm.
You do not have to have your taxes filed. That's what parents do not understand. They think that, oh, I'm not going to file my taxes until April and so forth. File it. You just estimate your income and then go back in and correct your FAFSA by updating it with the after you have filed your taxes.
Right.
So, you know,
people should know that's the financial aid form.
That is the financial aid form.
Get different grants and other opportunities that might be available.
Available mm-hmm. through the actual college itself.
Gotcha.
So that's my big thing, is just to make sure that they get their FAFSA in and start. I work with them on finding little small individual one-off scholarships that may be available locally. The national scholarships that are available out there, you see, oh, Coca-Cola and all these other big name scholarships that are out there, they're highly competitive. So you get the scholarships that are local that may only have five applicants.
Mm-hmm.
So should
you write those off, those big ones that are very competitive? I mean, you are competing with students across the country. I think there was one my daughter found, and they said, we'll stop taking applications when we reach 25,000. And I thought, 25,000 applications, how are they going to boil it down to the 20 that they're going to give money to?
Right.
But should you just necessarily write those off because they are so large or
I
not?
I do not. I don't suggest that at all. My point is, let them tell you no.
Mm.
You know, mm-hmm. always just apply, and then if you don't hear anything or you don't receive any money, then you can't say you didn't try.
Right.
And that's what parents need to understand. There are so many opportunities out there, and even while the child is in high school, there are opportunities that they can do to even just reduce the costs. For parents that have a late start, if their child did well in school but they haven't applied for any scholarships, they may have missed the early deadline in order to get scholarships through that college, they need to maybe consider CLEP exams, the college level examination program,
mm-hmm.
Administered through collegeboard.org. Once they're admitted in the college, there's like almost 3,000 colleges that offer CLEP exams. So if the child is, for instance, a whiz at English, they may be able to look at CLEPing out of the English 100 when they go into college.
Right.
Now, that test costs $80 versus, I don't know, $300-$400 a credit hour class at some universities. So those are just cost reduction options that I can, you know, share with parents, information I can share with parents to do.
One of the other tips you had that I think which was really good was the importance of writing and telling your story. A lot of times the only thing that those committees that are reviewing the applications have to go by is how what your story says,
exactly.
How well written your story is, because
mm-hmm.
everybody has the grades, right? And everybody's going to have all these classes that they took, and most everybody's going to have the community volunteering stuff for the most part. So you may all look the same, but if you're able to really translate your story well in a well-written way, you said that pays off sometimes.
Absolutely. you know, a well-written essay can go a long way with many of these scholarships, because and some of the scholarships require that the child writes an essay. You know, if your child isn't, you know, necessarily great in English or not a great writer, it may pay off for you to invest a little money into maybe some tutoring or someone to assist the child in writing that essay. Once, you know, they articulate that on paper, you know, I suggest just keeping it and tweaking it. Mm-hmm, you mm-hmm. know, once you get
make
a really
it easy
good
on
one,
yourself.
Make it easy on yourself. Use that repeatedly for different opportunities that may be out there. So I totally agree with you there. It is definitely important that the child writes a great essay. And furthermore, they also need to be able to present themselves well once, you know, in a situation like what you and I are doing here, an interview situation.
Yeah.
You know, they need to be able to articulate their story as well as they do when they write it on paper. So just walking your child through interview skills and presenting themselves to other people will go a long way as well.
This is very valuable information, for sure, for sure. I want to make sure we get people to where you are. So Information Village, we've got the information there on our screen, as you can see. It's information-village.com, and that way you can get to that website and then go from there to get to this lady who has all sorts of helpful tips on helping you figure out that plan of attack, that approach for you to get your kid to college, not just the academics, obviously, and the athletics, but also the resources that are available. Let's take a quick break. When we come back, we'll have some more. Stay with us. We'll be right back.